Praise the Lord, everyone. Praise the Lord, everyone. Praise the Lord, everyone. We're asking you to stand to your feet with us this evening as we sing praises to our Lord. If you can, touch and connect with the person who is next to you as we approach our God in prayer. Dear Lord and Father, we just want to thank you so much. You have ushered us into this place. We are here to hear from you. We are here to be moved and challenged by you. We're here, Lord, to be taken to another level in you. We pray in Jesus' name that you will have your way.
Yes,
and once again, may the train of your robe fill the temple. And after you're finished filling the temple, fill our hearts, oh God. In the mighty name of Jesus, let everyone say amen.
Amen.
Amen. I've heard someone say amen. That if it was nice, you need to do it twice. And so yesterday we had such a wonderful time in God. If you've been blessed by these amazing musicians, will you put your hands together and bless God? Yesterday we had such an amazing time in God that we're going back to where we started yesterday. Then we're going to go on a journey of praise. Anyone ready to praise the Lord with us?
Hallelujah.
Anyone ready to worship our God with us? To lift him a little bit higher? Hymn one more time. We're going to hit it one more time. Verse 1 and verse 3. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise him, for he is thy help and salvation. All ye who hear, now to his temple draw near. Join ye in glad adoration. I'm looking for the sons and daughters of the Most High God to join with us as we worship his holy name. If you're a son or daughter of God, let me hear you say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let the sons and daughters of God say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Here we go. Praise to the Lord.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise him, for he is thy help and salvation. All ye who hear, now to his temple draw near.
Receive the praise.
No one else can receive the praise.
Because he's holy.
holy,
righteous,
omnipotent,
mighty, Alpha,
Omega,
Redeemer, my Savior.
Say,
no one else can receive the glory.
No one else can receive the glory.
No one else can receive the praise.
No one else can receive the praise.
Come on, no one else can receive the glory.
No one else can receive the glory.
No one else can receive the praise.
No one else can receive the praise.
Because he's holy. And righteous, omnipotent,
and mighty,
Alpha,
Omega,
Redeemer,
my Savior,
because he's holy,
righteous,
omnipotent,
and
mighty,
Alpha,
Omega,
Alpha,
Omega,
Alpha,
Omega,
Alpha,
Omega,
Alpha,
My Redeemer, my Savior,
saying
no one else can receive the glory.
No one else can receive the glory.
No one else can receive the praise.
No one else can receive the praise.
Saying no one else can receive the glory.
No one else can receive the glory.
No one else can receive the praise.
No one else can receive the praise.
Because he's holy,
righteous,
omnipotent,
and mighty,
Alpha,
Omega,
my Redeemer. One more time, say, no one else can receive the glory.
No one else can receive the glory.
No one else can receive the praise.
No one else can receive the praise.
Because he's holy,
holy,
and righteous,
righteous,
omnipotent,
omnipotent,
and mighty,
mighty,
Alpha,
Alpha,
Omega,
Omega,
my Redeemer,
my Redeemer,
and my Savior.
How you loose my shackles and you set me free. How you made a way out of no way. Turned my darkness into day. You've been my joy in the time of sorrow. Hope for my tomorrow. Peace in the time of storm. Strength
I could never repay.
Boy, I can never repay you, Lord, for what you've done for me.
Oh.
How you loose my shackles and you set me free.
How you
made a way out of no way.
I searched all over, couldn't find nobody. Come on and sing. I searched all over,
yes,
couldn't find nobody. looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Hey, nobody greater. Nobody greater. Nobody greater than you. You know it. Come on and sing with us. If it's true for you, then lift your hands and say, I searched all over. Couldn't find nobody.
Couldn't find nobody.
Picked up my phone and called my friends. They couldn't help me.
Still couldn't find nobody.
Nobody greater.
Nobody greater.
There ain't nobody greater than you.
Nobody greater. Nobody greater than you.
Nobody greater, nobody greater,
nobody greater. Nobody greater,
nobody greater,
nobody greater than you.
No matter how skilled you are, no matter how many degrees you have, no matter how hard you preach, ain't nobody but Jesus. Ain't nobody but Jesus. You can't save yourself, you can't heal yourself, you can't deliver yourself from the stuff that you're in. Ain't nobody but Jesus.
Nobody great.
Nobody great.
Nobody great. Nobody greater than you.
Worship your holy name, God. So as we continue in this service, God, ask that you let your Holy Spirit fill this room, God, and fill our hearts. I ask that you touch every person and every pew, God, and the participants in this service. Ask that you let your Holy Spirit fall afresh on us. that we leave this century not the same and ignite a fire in us, oh God. In your name I pray, amen.
Good evening and praise the Lord, everybody. Somebody came hungry and thirsty tonight. And if you came seeking, you will find. Would you say amen? Turn to somebody next to you and said, I came seeking and I came hungry tonight. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. We welcome you again to another night of Elijah 3.0. Ready, restore, and reap. To God be the glory, for you have come far and near to be blessed in the name of Jesus. Tonight, we don't need to introduce him, but we want to welcome the pastor of the Oakwood University Church as he comes and shares a special, special greeting to us. Dr. Carlton Byrd, I do believe he's in the house, and as he is making his way, we want to just praise God for him coming to welcome us. And as he is coming, and if he doesn't come, I'm going to move forward and he'll come on. But tonight we're happy to have also with us the first female editor of the historic and oldest religious journal in the United States, Message Magazine. Not only is she the first female editor, but she is the daughter of the former editor. And right before she comes, let's welcome Dr. Byrd as he welcomes us.
Thank you, Dr. Williams. Good evening, everyone. Sister Crawford, you can come with me. In fact, I still believe in chivalry, so I will allow you this opportunity, and then I will close out, if that's right. Can we welcome Sister Carmela Monk Crawford?
Good evening, church. Good evening. We've been working hard with your Message Magazine. It's been a busy few days. We've been going out. We had a wonderful, fabulous photo shoot for our interactive Bible study called The Experience. And I want to introduce to you or have Stan, our Nikon certified photographer, Pastor Chaplain Ronald Pollard, and Ms. Danita Jones, I don't know if she's here, our production manager. We have beautiful costumes and these beautiful Oakwood University students placed in Bible character scenes so that in the pages of Message Magazine, we can have beautiful art that looks like us. It is so beautiful and wonderful, wonderful thing. So today we shot Judas, and today we also shot the three women that were at the tomb as they were talking to the angel. It was so wonderful to be able to talk to them. How does it feel to be an angel? And they said, you know, I don't know. I've never been told that before. But it was a very interesting time. Listen, I want you to know Message Magazine is working. Message, and if you haven't had the opportunity to use Message Magazine, you need to know that it works. When you use it, if you work it, it will work. We went out this summer and we passed out 30,000 Message magazines, I should say in October, at the Million Man March. Just in advance of Pope Francis's appearance in Philadelphia, we did 30,000 Message magazines in Philadelphia to let people know about family. What a wonderful opportunity. Many people from Allegheny East were there to participate in that. We went to the Tom Joyner family reunion and signed up people who have never heard about Message Magazine, 400 subscriptions on the spot. I never heard about this, the oldest black religious magazine in the country. Yes, I want to know. Sign me up. God is good and people want to know. Let me tell you something. For the next year, our campaign is Find Somebody to Win. Find somebody, because every day we have people that we're working with that they're invisible. They're in the background. They're the hairdresser, the people that's the shampoo lady. There's somebody there that you can win if you have the opportunity. Every great movie, you ever notice this? Every great movie comes down to hand-to-hand combat. You ever thought about that? Mission Impossible, you can have the fastest, coolest plane. You can have all of the armory and the weapons that you need, but the exciting scenes come when it's in the hand-to-hand combat, and that's how it works. Lest you think I'm too violent, you remember, and I am sometimes. I'm sorry. Lest you think I'm too violent, you remember what it was like when you're seeking the hand or the attention of somebody that you care about. Do you remember how thrilling it was just to have a little talk? You know, we forgot how to talk to people. Don't you know that? Forgot how to, but when you wanted their attention, you knew, and you had the thing that you needed to say. You ever tried that? You know, excuse me, do you believe in love at first sight? Or do I need to walk by again? We used to have game. Remember that when it was something that we wanted to do or we wanted to be a part of? This is our opportunity. Each one can reach out to someone that they love and someone that they want to see in the kingdom. Find somebody to win with Message Magazine 2016. God bless you.
Too often we are casual about our legacy ministries, as if Message is an option or not, as if Breath of Life is an option or not. Tonight, preachers of God, people of God, we need to commit to say, I know somebody that I can subscribe Message to myself. Come on and say amen. And share the good news of Jesus Christ. Dr. Bird does it every week here in this pulpit for the Breath of Life broadcast around the world. Would you welcome Dr. Carlton Bird tonight, everybody?
Thank you, Dr. Ivor Williams. Good evening, everyone. We are grateful that we can be a part of Breath of Life Television Ministries. Come on, say amen. God has blessed Breath of Life, and last year we celebrated 40 years. Come on. Elder C.D. Brooks, Elder Walter Pearson, and I'm grateful that I can just fill their shoes and stand here today and stand on their shoulders. The Lord blessed us this year abundantly. We began the year, we conducted 4 public campaigns this year. And God blessed us in this sanctuary, in this church, in this spring. The Lord blessed us with 71 baptisms. Come on, say amen. We then went down to San Antonio, Texas, right before the general conference session. We even partnered with Message Magazine. All the visitors who came nightly to the meetings, they received a 1-year subscription to Message Magazine. Come on, say amen. God blessed us, and the Lord gave us not only 136 new baptisms, but the Lord gave us the 14th Breath of Life Church. Come on, say amen. From there, we went to St. Louis, Missouri, 1 mile from Ferguson, where Michael Brown was tragically killed. We conducted a revival there. The Lord gave us 82 baptisms. And then from there, the 4th and final meeting of 2015 was in Stamford, Connecticut. There was no Seventh-day Adventist presence in the Northeastern Conference in Stamford. God bless. We went, we labored, we preached, and God gave us 57 new baptisms, and we started the 15th Breath of Life Church. Amen. So we thank you for your prayers. We thank you for your support. We need your continued prayers and support. Next month, January the 30th, right here in this sanctuary at the Oakwood University Church, we've been contacted by ABC Television. And they want the Seventh-day Adventist Church, I can't get a witness in this place, Breath of Life in particular, to conduct an Easter special. Somebody said, Bird, well, we don't believe in all that Easter with all the bunnies and the eggs. I said, we don't believe in all that, but we do serve a risen Savior. What do you say, everybody? And so on the 30th of January, right here from this sanctuary, we, in harmony with ABC Television, will have a taping for a special Easter program. Yours truly will preach the Word of God. Grammy Award-winning artist C.C. Winans will be with us, along with Jaime Jorge, violinist Jamie George, and then the Oakwood University Aeolians. We will tape it right here from this sanctuary on Easter Sunday, March the 27th, 2016, across all the ABC affiliates in the United States. the Breath of Life Easter special on ABC television. Come on, I need a witness in this place. Praise God. And what we want to do, because breath is not my ministry, it's God's ministry he's given to us. What we want to do is, as individuals begin to call in, and they say, we watch the broadcast, we watch Dr. Bird, we want to know the Breath of Life affiliate church in our city, in our area. We want to be able to point them to your church, to you as a pastor, so you can have some interest names. Come on, say amen. So this initiative is not just for me, not just for Oakwood, but for all of us. Because when we all lift, it makes the load lighter. Thank you for your support to Oakwood University. Thank you for your support to Message Magazine. And thank you for your support to Breath of Life Television Ministries. These are our ministries. And we've got to keep our ministries going. What do you say, everybody? Now, tonight is Community Night at PELC. So on behalf of the Oakwood University Church, the senior pastor of this church, yours truly, Dr. Carlton Bird, we would like to welcome you to this special worship experience because we've got a preacher in the house. Come on, say amen. And he's going to preach a word from the Lord. I remember Dr. Cosby, he was at Wheeler Avenue. I was at the Belfort Church. Maya Culverson was a member of the Belfort. You know, she's do PR work for you. Well, I couldn't pay her like you, but she did some for me too because her grandparents were members of the Belfort Church, which is now World Harvest Outreach Seventh Avenue Church. We welcome you to the pulpit here at Oakwood University Church tonight. If there's anything that we can do, anything we can help you with while you're here tonight, to our pastors, our visiting friends, and even community residents who are here tonight, feel free to pull us by the coattail, let us know, and we'll be more than happy to help you. God bless you, and welcome to the Oakwood University Church.
Thank you, Dr. Bird. You know, night after night at PELC, you see people here, and you see them doing many different things. Pastor Damian Chandler is not only a pastor and praise and worship leader, but you all need to know, he just ran an evangelistic meeting, and the Lord gave him almost 40 souls. He's going to come and lead us tonight in our hymn, the senior pastor of the Capital City Church in Sacramento, California. Let us stand as we prepare to sing our hymn of praise.
There's a lot of things to get excited about when it comes to God. But how many people are excited that he lived, that he died, and then he rose? The song says, alas, did my Savior bleed and did my Sovereign die? Did he devote a sacred hand for someone such as I? Touch a person around you and say, he did it for me. He did it for me. He did it for me. Touch someone behind you and say, he did it for me. Then when you're finished touching them with your right hand, put your right hand with your left hand. Put your hands together as we sing about a Savior. Oh, up there in the balcony, put your hands together. Now we can't move until you move. We ain't gonna move till you move. So if you forgive me, please forgive me. Please forgive me. We're gonna turn this Oakwood University. We're gonna turn this into a choir. You ready? There we go. I see ya. Alas, and did my Savior bleed? Here we go.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed?
Come on.
Pray for sorrow.
clapping. Elder Nixon, you know, from the time you start clapping, you can't stop. From the time you start rocking, you can't stop. So join this choir. Put your hands together. Put your hands together. Verse 2, was it?
Was it?
I'm if you don't mind. Crown him Lord of Lords, if you don't mind, for my friend and our Savior, if you can stand to your feet as we spend time talking to the Lord this evening. While you're standing, if you can just grab your neighbor's hand, and I just want to stand on a platform of the Word of God, which says 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse number 5. Excuse me, verse number 6, wherein greatly ye rejoice, though now for a season, if need be ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. Heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. God, in the solemnity of this moment, in the stillness of this hour, God, we've come from the north and south, from the east and the west to tabernacle here one more time. God, our theme, and you knew this before the world was formed and shaped, was Elijah 3.0. And as we read the story of Elijah, many of us see ourselves in the great prophet. We've seen how you've moved when we stood before demons and we cried the call standing on the word of God, and we watched demons run at your name. But God, if we're honest, we've stood in the cave, afraid of Jezebel and her imps. And yet, God, we marvel at the fact that you still called us to this thing called ministry. So we're standing on your word that even though, Lord, we are standing with our suits and we look handsome, God, many of us are still hurting. There's some of us that came in wonderful dresses, but God, on the inside, we're broken. And so we're asking just one more time that you will stop by this place. God, because there's a preacher that accepted the call of Jesus Christ to proclaim the everlasting gospel, Lord, and while he's out preaching, the enemy has been wreaking havoc in his home. And so, God, we're just gonna bypass all of the great things we can say, and we're just saying, God, save our children. God, we've baptized hundreds, God, collectively thousands, and yet and still it seems as if the bedrooms of our children's rooms have been a gateway to the enemy. And right now, in the name of Jesus, there's a preacher right here that's smiling on the outside, but hurting and broken on the inside. And God, we still believe that there's power, wonder-working power at the name of Jesus. So God, for somebody's child, I need you to save them in the name of Jesus. God, they may be a child, they may be an adult, but God, right now, because you said if we contend with you, you will contend with our children. God, that you'll save our families. God, that you'll protect our marriages in the name of Jesus. But God, there's somebody else who has preached this everlasting gospel, but their faith in you has faltered. God, we've prayed for others. We've seen you do great miracles, but in our lives, our spiritual account is bankrupt. So, God, today we came because the same way you sent a still small voice to speak to Elijah. God, today, in the stillness of this moment, through the music ministry, through the spoken word of our pastor that's going to come and share a word today, God, transform somebody's faith. And by doing so, God, give them a glimpse of their future. That's all we ask, God. We acknowledge that revelation is true, that we are wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. From the conference president to the person in the two-member church, we need you, Jesus. So would you? Could you? One more time. Stop by you. Because it's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord. Standing in the need of prayer. Disappoint us not, God. Saturate us with your spirit and allow us to leave here changed. In the magnanimous name of Jesus. The name that still has wonder-working power. That we can all hail the power of Jesus' name. As tonight we crown you Lord of all. In your name we pray.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord. We're going to be quick on tonight so that we can get in out of the way of this word from the Lord. Amen. Anybody looking forward to getting to heaven?
Oh, yes.
I think that's something to get excited about, just the thought about it. Everything will be worth it after a while. Amen. It's a little song, Dynamic Praise Singers. It just says, soon and very soon. I'm gonna meet him in the air. No more crying there, no more dying there. Looking forward to meeting him, amen.
Come on, let's put our hands together and bless God tonight. What a joy it is, and this is a fantastic night. Am I right about it? Anybody glad to be in God's house tonight? Why don't you turn to your neighbor, shake your neighbor's hand real good, and say, I'm glad to be seated next to you tonight. You came on a good night. Yes, Lord. We are so glad to have you here tonight. Just a little bit of housekeeping. We've had a fantastic time these last 2 days. If you missed that 6 o'clock recognition service, you need to get the DVD. Come on, say amen. We recognize many of our pioneers, and that is going to be available along with all of the messages that have been preached and seminars that have been presented up to this point. So get that material. Lord's going to bless you real good. But tonight is a fantastic night. We are just so encouraged to see so many of you here from the community. We want you to feel at home here tonight. Come on, say amen. I don't know about y'all, but I came here to shout. Come on, say amen. Y'all missed what I just said. Every now and sometimes people don't recognize why preachers holler the way they do. Sometimes you just got to holler to save your mind. Come on, say amen. Save your family. So we come here to celebrate. We come to worship God, and we ain't gonna make no apologies about it. Come on, say amen. I felt that too. Come on, say amen. We came here to worship the Lord. You know why? Somebody said, tell me why. Because he's worthy to be praised. We serve a good God. I want you to know that we have made a little mistake in our program that I want to bring to your attention. We value Linda Pinnick, who is the director of the Spouses Organization. Put your hands together for Linda Pinnick. And for reasons that we don't have the time to go in right now, the program for the Spouses program was omitted. Now, we've been emailing you that material, but I think that they deserve an apology for not being included in the bulletin, because they have done an amazing job putting together an amazing program. Put your hands together for the Spouses Ministry. If you look at your bulletins, you'll recognize that tomorrow at 8:30 they begin again, if not 9 o'clock. I think we've sent some updates out. I'm glad tonight to have one of my home girls here from Memphis, Tennessee, Sherry Jones Moffitt, amen, has ministered for us in many of our meetings, and we want you to get to know her so that she can minister in your meetings. And our preachers in the house, we're thanking God for Dr. Marcus Cosby, senior pastor of the Wheeler Avenue Baptist Church in Houston, Texas. May God be praised. He is going to be introduced by the newest member of the faculty here, the religion faculty, Dr. Wesley Knight. Let's praise God for him.
Praise God tonight. The Bible says, how can they call on one whom they have not believed? And how can they believe if they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? Tonight we have a preacher in the house. The senior pastor of the Wheeler Avenue Baptist Church. He has matriculated through Fisk University, also went to the house for his master's divinity in homiletics, also holds a doctoral degree in homiletics as well, so he is well prepared. But the question still remains, how shall they hear without a preacher? And we do have a preacher in the house. I remember going to Dr. Jeremiah Wright's church when he was there, Trinity, every year, just about you would come for the 7 last words. And we were so elated and blessed as the word of God was preached. He preaches with power and with pathos, and he is one that will bring the word of God to life tonight. I'm excited because when he stands up to preach, you can tell that the anointing of the Holy Ghost is always on him. And it fills and permeates the atmosphere. And so tonight, we're going to hear a word from the Lord. Yesterday, on Sunday, he preached 5 services at his church. over 13,000 members. God has his hand of favor on him. There is a word from the Lord tonight. So Dr. Cosby, we welcome you to this place. We praise God for you. We know that God is going to use you real good. And I've learned not to play around on the tracks when a train is coming. So I'm going to get out the way so God can have his way. But I just want to admonish you to preach. Preach like it's your last day preaching. Preach, because somebody needs to hear a word from the Lord. Preach till you make your jacket want to come off. Preach. Preach till somebody wants to live right. Preach, preacher. Preach until we holler, till we can't holler no more. Preach the word until the devil leaves the building. Preach until Jesus is exalted. Preacher, preacher, preach.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Are you glad to be in the house of the Lord tonight? Are you glad to be in the presence of the Lord tonight? Are you ready to hear a word from the Lord tonight? I'm honored to be here with you, and I just came to share a little bit of God in me with God in you. Is that all right? Now, this is a very sacred space. This is a very sacred time. And those that have been honored to call and called by God to serve in whatever capacity is serious business. So I know we're in the digital age where everybody's got your phones recording. But I'm going to ask tonight so that I don't get confused and think this moment is about me, that you don't record while I'm ministering tonight. Is that all right? I want to talk to you a little bit about grace. Has anybody ever experienced the grace of God? I still have peace. I still believe. I can conquer anything, and it's still by the grace of God. Still have hope. I've come through worse before, but I've never walked alone. I've been kept by the grace of God. Oh, still believe anything, yeah. Still have hope. Worse before, never ever walked alone. So as long as Jesus reigns, this too shall pass away. Through it all, I can say that it's still. It's been a trying last few years. I've had to shed many tears, but I would not be standing here, no, if not. Don't need another cliche when you've had to deal with real pain. Is there a witness that can say that it's still? Jesus reigns. This
can say that it's still for every challenge you face, there is a way to escape. Don't let it take away your faith. You've come through by the grace of God. Of God. By the grace of God, oh Lord. By grace. You've come through by grace. That's why you stand in here today.
If you just give me a few minutes, I can tell you all about it. I still have hope. I've come through worse before, but I have never walked alone. And if you tell the truth, you ain't walked alone either. I've been kept by the grace. They said my daughter wouldn't live. Can I tell my testimony tonight? Said I couldn't get pregnant again. And now I have two. My baby's almost 10 years old. She was born 1 pound, 5 ounces. I have a son that's 7 years old. And he was born at 9 months, and he was born 13 pounds. Still. By the grace. Can I say it the way we used to sing it before my daddy preached? Amazing grace. I wonder, can you hear how sweet it sounds? Oh, that sing. Thank you, Lord. Once mercy, Lord, but now, right now I'm found. And oh, I was, I'm not anymore, but I was blind. I wonder, can I get a witness out there? But now I still have peace. I wish I could sing it like I feel it tonight. Because I know some of you have been going through a lot of changes. But you got to remember the word of God is true. And whatever he promised over your life, he cannot lie. I still believe I can conquer anything. And it's still by the grace of, let me hear you say, clap your hands and give God praise in this room tonight.
I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting. And his truth endures to all generations. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who trusts in him. If you're excited about who God is and what the Lord has done in your life this day, won't you take some time now to give God praise all over this place for God's goodness and God's grace, for his grandeur and his glory. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. What a joy it is to be in this place on this night as we share together as the people of God in this conference that brings us together to equip ourselves even the more to serve this God of ours and this present age in which we live. How I thank God for all those who have been instrumental in my coming to share in this time. To the pastor of this place, Dr. Bird, I thank God for you, and to our Dr. Wilson, and to all those who have ensured that we have been able to come together to share tonight. Dr. Pollard, I thank God for you. To Dr. Knight, who so kindly introduced me, thank you, sir. And to all of the preachers of the gospel who have been so kind to me during this time, sharing text messages and words of encouragement, God bless you. Thank you so much for the privilege of being here with you. Sister Sherry, you're a blessing to the body of Christ. Thank you so much for your ministry of music. And thank God for all of these musicians and singers who have blessed us, ushering us into the presence of God on the wings of song. It is good for us to be here, and to God be the glory for the great things he has done. There's a word from the Lord tonight, and if you have your Bibles, I invite your attention to a familiar passage of Scripture found in the Old Testament prophecy of Isaiah. The Old Testament prophecy of Isaiah at chapter 6. The Old Testament prophecy of Isaiah at chapter 6. We'll begin our reading tonight at verse 1. The Old Testament prophecy of Isaiah at chapter 6. And we'll begin our reading tonight at verse 1. If you have that passage of Scripture, say amen. Amen. If you don't, say wait for me. I'm waiting. I heard you. The Old Testament prophecy of Isaiah, just before Jeremiah, you'll find the book of Isaiah at chapter 6. Beginning tonight at verse 1. I'm reading tonight from the New International Version of the Holy Word of God. And this is what it says. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on his throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. That's enough. Amen. Praise God for his holy word. Amen. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated upon his throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. For the time that is ours to share together tonight, I want to talk from the subject, I'm on divine assignment. I'm on divine assignment. The majority of us who occupy space in this place tonight know what it means to have been given a divine assignment. We know what it means to have been picked out by God, chosen by God, to be used by God, to bless God's people as we bless God's holy name. The majority of us who occupy space in this place today have been energized by our assignments, even as we recognize that there have been some burdens that accompany that assignment. So every now and then we have to revisit the assignment, revisit that defining moment when we heard God's voice calling us, when we experienced God laying his hand on us, sending us forth to do the work that had been assigned to our hands. Divine assignment with a defining moment. Every one of us should remember that moment. We should have in our minds readily available to us as a part of our testimony that day, that night, that moment when God said, I want you. I've chosen you. If we ever forget that, we just might lose our passion. We just might lose our fervor. That night, that day when tears came streaming down your face and you said, yes, Lord. That night when you heard his voice like you had never heard it before and you said, yes, Lord. That day when nothing else mattered. You were so sold out, so committed, so on fire that nobody could detour you. Nobody could deter you. Nothing could thwart your passion for doing what you knew you had been called to do. Do you remember that time? Do you remember that moment? Do you remember the experience when you said, I will go wherever you send me. I will do whatever you tell me to do. That defining moment that nobody can take away from you. It cannot easily be erased from your memory. Do you recall it? Won't you refresh your memory even right now and remind yourself of that very moment when you said, God, here I am. Use me for your glory. Here I am. Do with me whatever you choose to do. Every one of us must have that defining moment. I remember mine. I'll never forget it as long as I live, because it was in that moment that I knew without any shadow of doubt that God chose to use me for his glory. And every now and then when the saints get on my nerves, every now and then when it seems like the pressure is too much, every now and then when I get on my own nerves, I say, God, here I am again. And I remember that moment when you called me and I said, yes. For Isaiah, it was in the year. That King Uzziah died. He'll never forget it. It's imprinted upon his memory. It's etched into his mind. He cannot escape the reality. He remembers it as if it were yesterday. It was in the year that King Uzziah died. It was that time for him of personal tragedy. Have you ever been there where you had some moment of personal tragedy that could not easily be removed from your memory? For Isaiah, it was in that year when the king who was on the throne of the nation, he died, and it was for him a moment of personal tragedy. You must understand, Uzziah and Isaiah had great relations with one another. Some say they were cousins. Others say it was an uncle-nephew relationship. Others say they were just good friends. Whatever the relationship was, they had a strong bond one with another. And in the year that Uzziah died, it hurt him to the core. It made his heart bleed. It broke his heart beyond belief. And someone listening to me tonight understands what grief can do to you when it grips you and disallows you to have the progress, the productivity, and the promotion you wish you had. Have you ever been gripped by grief? I know we've understood what it means to press our way through and to keep on praising despite what happens, but sometimes grief will put a stranglehold on you. Sometimes grief will arrest you and refuse to let you go. It was in the year that King Uzziah died, when the grief was so great that Isaiah knew he could not handle it by himself. It was in the year that King Uzziah died, when his tears kept falling and could not find any swift release from the grief that he felt. It was in the year that King Uzziah died, the personal tragedy refused to give him the progress, the productivity, the promotion he wished he had. But that wasn't all that was challenging, because not only was it a personal tragedy for Isaiah, it was also political tragedy for the nation. The nation is now dealing with the reality that the king is gone. And you know your Bible. He's been a good king, not the best king, but certainly not the worst king. He's been a good king. He's been on the throne for some time now. He has reigned for several years now, and now Isaiah and the nation have to deal with the reality that the king is gone. It's a time of personal tragedy for one, political tragedy for others, and now they're at a crossroads. It's a defining moment. And in this defining moment, Isaiah has to struggle, wrestle with the reality that something's got to be done to get him over the hump. Sometimes you get stuck, and you need something to move you past where you are to where you need to be. Isaiah is in a moment of crossroads, a defining moment. Isaiah is dealing with the death of Uzziah, but he's dealing with it from a perspective where he cannot literally move to the place he needs to be, because he is outside of the place that will give him the most comfort. From contextual implications, we can deduce that he is either at the house, or he is somewhere in a work environment. We do not know where he is, but one thing we do know, he made a decision to move from where he was to get to the temple. Bible says in the year King Uzziah died, when he was gripped by grief, he made the decision to make his way to the temple. I don't know how God does it, but there is something that God does inside the temple that just can't be done outside the temple. There is something that God does when you get to his house that just won't happen at your house. There's something that God does when you're standing on holy ground that just won't happen when you're standing out there. Is there anybody in this place tonight who can testify, if I can just get to church, my trouble might not be all over, but it's just something that God does by the time I get in here. It's something that happens when I get into this sacred space. Maybe that's why the psalmist says, child, I was glad when they said unto me, let's go to the house of the Lord, because something happens in here. Something happens in this place that cannot happen in other spaces. As a matter of fact, when you come into the presence of God and you know beyond any shadow of doubt that you're in his presence, God will make sure that you understand you're not in a casual atmosphere. Come here, Moses, take your shoes off, for the ground you're standing on is holy ground. Don't treat me in a casual manner. Don't treat me as if I'm not the holy other. Don't treat me as if I'm one of your boys or one of your friends. I'm God all by myself, and I can do what nobody else is able to do. In the year King Uzziah died, in the year King Uzziah died, I was pressed into the temple. I couldn't handle that outside the temple. I couldn't deal with it in my own confines. I couldn't handle it in my own residence. So I went to the house of the Lord. And when I got to the house of the Lord, I saw things from a different perspective. I saw things from a different vantage point. I saw a glimpse of God's glory
that literally changed my whole mind, changed my whole attitude in the year King Uzziah died. I saw that while I was outside the temple. But when I got inside the temple, I saw the Lord. Oh, child of God, please don't miss this. He says, I saw the upheaval outside the temple. I saw the challenges outside the temple. But when I got in the temple, I saw something totally different. Oh, child of God, I quoted to you tonight from the New International Version, but that's not the version I grew up on. Maybe there's somebody like me who grew up on the old school King James Version, because the King James Version inserts a four-letter word that blesses my socks off every time I read it. It says, in the year King Uzziah died, watch this, I saw also the Lord. Oh, I can't deny the reality that I saw the death of King Uzziah. But when I got into the temple, although I knew that the king had died, when I got into the temple, I realized that the King of Kings was still alive and well. And may I please announce to somebody at Oakwood that the King of Kings is alive and well. And I just came to join the choir and say, all hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Hallelujah. In the year King Uzziah died, I saw that and it frustrated me. I saw that and it almost crippled me. I saw that and it broke my heart. So I had to get to the temple. And when I got to the temple, I also saw the Lord. In the year Freddie Gray died. In the year Tamir Rice died. In the year Laquan McDonald died. In the year the Emmanuel Nine died. In the year that black bodies have been strewn across city streets like strange fruit, no longer on a lynching tree, but now in the corners of our communities. In the year that all those bodies were dead, I saw that. It broke my heart. I got angry. I got frustrated. So I got myself to the temple. And when I got to the temple, I also saw the Lord. Hallelujah. I also saw the Lord. And when I saw him, he was seated on his throne. And when I saw him, he was high and lifted up. And when I saw him, his train filled the temple. Child of God, may I please tell somebody listening to me tonight, if we're going to remember and maintain our divine assignment, I suggest to you, first of all, of my three little points, I suggest to you, first of all, that we need to once again be mesmerized by God's majesty. I said we need to be mesmerized by God's majesty. Will somebody please holler at me, mesmerized? When was the last time God wowed you? When was the last time God gave you an eye-popping, jaw-dropping experience that left you saying, wow? Here's the challenge, especially when we come to meetings like this. Most of us in the room are professional church people. So we don't get wowed like we used to. Back in the day, the slightest thing God did left us saying, ooh, thank you, Jesus. But now, we take it as commonplace. We've gotten so comfortable and accustomed to the things of God that now it's just going through the motions. And every now and then, God has to give us a defining moment that pushes us into the temple where it's just us and God, so that God can work on us before we go to work again. Every now and then we need to be wowed by him, by his greatness, his grandeur. We need to be mesmerized by his majesty. Look again at what he says. He says, in the year King Uzziah died, I also saw the Lord. And watch this, he was seated on his throne. Please, my brothers and sisters, may I please help you to understand that this right here is a position of authority. That God is seated on his throne. God is not pacing the floor. God is not twiddling his thumbs. God is not scratching his head trying to figure out, what do I do next? Uzziah's death did not catch God off guard, did not catch God by surprise, because God is seated, and that position of seated literally means that God is in total control. Oh, child of God, no matter how crazy this country of ours gets, no matter how crazy this world of ours gets, no matter how crazy our churches may sometimes seem to be, I came to announce to the Seventh-day Adventist community that God is still in complete control. I don't care what burdens came with you to this meeting. I don't care what challenges you've been thinking about since you've been in this meeting. I need you to understand beyond any shadow of doubt that God is in complete control. Even when your family's out of control, he's in control. When the church is out of control, he's in control. When the community's out of control, he's in control. When the country's out of control, he's in control. Who would have thought that Donald Trump would be the forerunner? When everything else is out of control, God is in complete. When you get out of control, God is still in control. He is seated on his throne. He's not frustrated like we may be. He's not challenged as we sometimes become. God is seated on his throne in a position of authority. But watch this. He's high and lifted up. That, my friends, is the position of majesty. He's high and lifted up. Watch this. He's above the fray. He's above the challenge. He's above the obstacle, above the frustration. He's high and lifted up. Now, child of God, this ought to bless you, because anybody understands that whenever you are highly exalted or above a situation, the higher you go, the smaller the things beneath you become. Now, you're missing it, because many of us get so challenged by our concerns and frustrations because we're looking at them from a ground zero perspective. I fly nearly every week of my life, and it does not take a rocket scientist to understand that the more altitude you get, the smaller everything beneath you becomes. And so God has to be high and exalted above the situation so that you don't think that God sees your problem in the same way you see your problem. God is not intimidated by your circumstance. He's not thrown off. His godness is not in jeopardy because you got some money challenges, some health challenges, some financial challenges. He is high and lifted up. And because I know you're a good student of the Bible, you ask the right questions, and you want to know, how did God get high and lifted up? You're asking some good questions. And if your Bible is still open, or if you remember the story, you'll know that in verse 2, your Bible says there's some seraphim that are above the throne, some six-winged angels. With two wings, they covered their faces. With two wings, they covered their feet. And with two wings, they did fly. And your Bible says that they began to cry out one to another. We say in the theological world, in antiphonal fashion. In the church, we just say call and response. They began to cry out one to another, and they said the same thing in triplicate fashion. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the more they cried out holy, the higher God became. Watch this. The Hebrew connotation of their calling out holy, 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 and God being high and exalted, high and lifted up, it literally says, it literally connotes that God was hoisted. Somebody say hoisted. That God was hoisted, that God was lifted up, hoisted above the fray, hoisted above the frustration, hoisted above the fatality of Uzziah. He was lifted, literally suggesting that the more the seraphim cried holy, the higher God became. And the higher God was exalted, the smaller the problem would become in the life of anybody who cried out holy. You want to know why I thank God for this picture of the seraphim? Because the seraphim are calling out one to another, literally suggesting that when we come into the temple, worship is never supposed to be a spectator sport. When somebody says holy over there, somebody's supposed to say holy over there. When somebody says thank you back there, somebody ought to say thank you up here. It's not time for us to be looking and say, I wonder what's wrong with them. Wonder what they're going through. Wonder what's happening at the house. No, if she says holy, he ought to say holy. If they say holy, they ought to say holy. Come on, let's have some class participation. Holy! 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 If you don't need anything from God, if you don't have any challenges in your whole life, that's all right. You ain't got to hoist them with the rest of us. But for some of us who need God to get big, exalted, magnified, I dare you to get out of your comfort zone and holler, holy. I really feel badly. I feel badly for the ones of us who can come to church and sit for 2 hours and never say anything. I feel badly for those of us who can have this wonderful worship experience and don't feel anything. But the more I see my sister getting happy, the more it makes me happy. The more Sharon started singing about grace, the more I thought about grace in my own life. The more I heard them talking about how good God has been and how they're going to plan to go to heaven, the more I said, I can't wait to see him for myself. Somebody in here ought to help somebody else cry, holy! King Uzziah died. I saw that. It hurt my heart. So I had to get to a different perspective, a different vantage point. So I went into the temple and I also saw the Lord. He was seated on his throne. He was high and lifted up. Watch this. And his train filled the temple. This is a metaphorical notion of the glory of God. Now we see God in a position of glory because holy has hoisted God. Now the glory of the Lord fills the house. Ooh, you just missed your shout cue. I just gave you reason to say amen. Oh, look it, even if you don't say it. Watch this. I said that while they're hoisting God, he's high and lifted up, and his glory is filling the temple. Glory, the kabod, the weight of God. Hebrew word is kabod, the weight of God. The reputation of God is filling the house. Literally suggesting that while we're hoisting God, God begins to throw his weight around. Oh, child of God, is there anybody in here who needs God to throw his weight around in some circumstance of your life? Maybe it's in your children's life. Maybe it's in your spouse's life. Maybe it's in your life. Maybe it's in your finances. Maybe it's in your church. But somebody ought to beg God, Lord, throw your weight. I'm still on point one. I'm trying to get to point three. In the year, King Uzziah died. I saw that, but that ain't all I saw. I saw also the Lord seated on his throne, high and lifted up, and his train, his glory, filled the temple. Seraphim were crying out, holy, holy, holy. The place got filled with smoke. The doorposts start shaking. And when Isaiah saw all of this, he was mesmerized. Isaiah was so gripped by the moment when he saw the glory, the grandeur, the goodness, the greatness of God. That Isaiah looked at God's glory, then looked at himself. And listen to what Brother Man said. Woe is me, for I'm undone. I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. Do you see what's going on here? Once you get mesmerized by God's majesty, you can't help but be mortified by your own human reality. Hey, I'm going to go to E flat at point 3. When you get mesmerized by God's majesty, you then likewise get mortified by your own human reality. Woe is me. I'm undone. When you compare yourself to God, the only logical response is woe is me. See, the challenge with the professional church people is we compare ourselves to one another. So we can always have a superiority complex if we're looking at people who don't seem to measure up to us. But when you compare yourself to the grandeur and the glory and the holiness of God, you only have one logical response: woe is me. And the church would be a whole lot better if preachers would look at God and say, woe is me. The church universal would be a whole lot better if teachers and leaders would compare themselves to God and in eventuality say, woe is me, I'm undone. I'm unclean. And if that wasn't bad enough, I hang out with folk who got the same issues I had. Woe is me, I'm undone, I'm unclean. Dwell in the midst of people of unclean lips. One of the things that we must always keep uppermost in our minds is that despite the fact that God chooses to use us, neither of us is worthy. Come on, come on. With your gifted self, with your anointed self, with your Holy Ghost-filled self, you're still not worthy. The Bible says all of our righteousness is of filthy rags. Professional church people have learned how to cover up their stuff. But last time I checked the Bible says all have sinned. I come from Texas, and I know how they talk in Texas. Most folk will say y'all have sinned, but that ain't what the Bible says. The Bible says all have sins. That means the person sitting in your seat right now, the person wearing your shoes right now, the person who has been talked so nicely about all week long, all year long, in all of these meetings because of your giftedness. You've got more sin than God can care to look upon. All of us have messed up. So Isaiah had to say, woe is me. And it was at that moment, when he says, woe is me, that the seraphim began to multitask. I said, all right, we've been waiting on this. And so they came down from above the throne, went down to the altar, took a hot coal off the altar with tongs, put it on his lips, says, we've been waiting for this, man. Because if you can confess it, God will help you conquer it. If you can face it, God will help you fix it. If you will just admit it, help me, Johnny Cochran, God will help you acquit it. Can I get 2 witnesses? Said your sin is pardoned, your iniquity is purged. We've been waiting on this right here because I'm so grateful that no matter how much mess we've gotten ourselves into, how many times we've offended the heart of God, the Bible says if we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I need 2 or 3 people to help me right through here and testify. I'm not perfect, but I'm being perfected. Can I get anybody in here to testify? I'm not all right, but thank God. God pardon me. I get excited talking about the Lord. But there's one more thing in the text, and I give it to you. And I promise I'll be back in my seat. Here it is. If we're going to fulfill our divine assignment, and all of us are on some assignment for the Lord, if we're going to have that assignment refreshed, if we'll have that assignment still maintain passion, I suggest to us tonight, Seventh-day Adventist Church, that we need to be mesmerized by God's majesty. I suggest to us tonight that we need to be mortified by our own human reality. When you get mesmerized and then mortified, may I please suggest to you from this text tonight that you'll get mobilized and magnetized by God's ability. I said he'll magnetize you, he'll mobilize you. Literally suggesting, child of God, that when you see all that God does, he literally draws you in. I don't know how God does it, but the more I think about how awesome he is, how amazing he is, it draws me in. I get magnetized by his ability so that I might be mobilized for his purposes in my life. I get magnetized. Have you ever been just drawn in? Have you ever been tired but couldn't stop? Have you ever been weary of the assignment but you knew that the call was so strong on your life that you couldn't sit down? That was a preacher like that. That was a preacher like that old preacher. He had one of those hard assignments from God. One of those hard assignments. He had to go tell the people, get right or get left. Old preacher had on those fire and brimstone sermons. And he said, I don't feel like preaching anymore because the people aren't responding. Not bringing the money. They're not doing what I tell them to do. They're not responding to the message I said. And he says, I'm just not going to preach no more. I'm going to go sit down somewhere. Take an early retirement. Tear up my license to preach. Tear up my papers. Tear up everything. I'm tired of this. And just as soon as he got ready to sit down, Jeremiah said it's like fire. Shut up in my bones. Said I wasn't going to tell nobody, but I just can't keep it to myself. Can I get two preachers in here who can testify? When I felt like throwing in the towel, I remembered that God called me, God anointed me, God assigned me. I can't keep quiet. I've been magnetized. I've been magnetized. That's why you can come to this meeting and keep on coming every day. Come to all the sessions. Come hear all the preaching. You hear all the preaching, you heard preaching earlier, came back for more preaching tonight because you get magnetized. Just want to hear, is there another word from the Lord? You in church last Sabbath, going to be in church next Sabbath because you kept getting magnetized. He just keeps on drawing you in. Every time you think about how he saved you, it draws you in. Every time you think about how he delivered you, it draws you in. Every time you think about how he called you, it draws you in. Every time you think about how he forgave you and forgave you and forgave you and forgave you and forgave you. Come on, E-flat. It draws you in. Is there anybody in here who can help me close this message and testify? I'm so sold out now that I can't sit down. I can't stop preaching. I can't stop teaching because he's drawn me in. Every time I think about what he's done, I get happy all over again. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me, my soul cries hallelujah. Thank God for saving me. Now for the next 20 seconds, I don't want us to celebrate being called. I don't want us to celebrate being pastor. I don't want us to celebrate being evangelist. I don't want us to celebrate being anointed. I want us to celebrate being saved. Is there anybody in church tonight who still gets excited about the fact that he saved you when you didn't deserve it? He saved you when you were in the muck and mire of sin. Is there anybody in here on a Monday night who can testify? The reason I praise him like I do is because he saved me. The reason I can't sit down is because he delivered me, and I feel like helping somebody to get over the hump you in, get over the trouble you in, get over the circumstance you facing. If you learn how to join the seraphim, I came to testify that your trouble problems. Stop telling your God how big your problems are. Start telling your problems how big your God is. And if there's anybody in church who feels like lifting him, won't you help me lift up Jesus? Is there anybody in church who feels like hoisting him above your sickness? Hoist him above your trouble. Hoist him. Lift Jesus. Lift Jesus higher. Lift him up. Lift him up. Still he speaks from eternity. And I, if I be lifted up, I'll draw him from the crack house. I'll draw him from the corners. I'll draw him from the pimp's house. I'll draw. Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Say yeah. Yes. 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 Lift him up. Lift him up. I wonder, will you help me lift Jesus? Will you help me lift Jesus? Preachers, will you help me lift him? Choir, will you help me lift him? Higher, 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 higher. Still fills the temple. And once he throws his weight around, I'll testify whatever he wants me to do. Here am I. Send me. Go back to your churches and fill the house with the glory of the living God. Hallelujah. 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 And amen.
Sometimes you gotta pat your own self on the back, yeah, yeah. You and no matter how you feel, speak whatever your mind, oh, you will be healed. Speak over yourself, encourage yourself in the Lord. Oh, sometimes you have to speak a word over yourself. Depression may be all around you, but God is a present help. Well, the enemy created walls, but remember giants, they do fall. Speak yourself in the Lord. Oh, as I minister to you, oh, I minister to myself. Life can hurt you so till you feel like I'm feeling. Say things like, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. And it may feel bad right now, but God is working it out for my good. Speak over yourself. Encourage yourself in the Lord. God bless you.
let's put our hands together and magnify God. Come on, we can do better than that. Let's put our hands together and thank God for what he's done in this place. Has anybody seen God high and lifted up tonight? I told you that every now and then you need to move away from the prescription medication, and it ain't nothing better every now and then, just a good holler. Come on, say amen. Sometimes you gotta holler or you gonna lose your mind. Some folk need to holler before they lose their family. And we're not hollering out of emotion. We're hollering because we serve a real good God who's worthy of our praise. Let's praise him just one more time. Thank God for Dr. Marcus Cosby, the minister of this evening. And we thank you, Sherry Jones Moffitt, or a minister of music, as they say in the truest sense of the word. Listen, this is the Lord's doing. And how many know it's marvelous in our eyes? And we thank you for coming out tonight. We want to just remind you again that on tomorrow we're going to begin at 8 a.m. What time are we going to begin? At 8 a.m. We're going to be right back in this auditorium, and you will be blessed by Ty Gibson. Ty Gibson has been seen on 3ABN. He's going to be talking about the Advent message. He'll be doing a seminar shortly afterwards. And after that, we will direct you to where the seminars will be. There have been some changes. We want to say one more time that we regret not having the program for the spouses seminars, I should say, but they will be meeting tomorrow, I believe at 9 o'clock, in Wade Hall. If that incorrect information is correct, you will receive an email blast tonight. I want you to stand to your feet right now as we prepare to close this service out. Immediately following this, come on up, Greg. Immediately following this service, there will be the conclusion of the appeal. The appeal is a coming together of creative public evangelism approaches coached by Dr. Carlton Bird and Deblia Snell, and who else was it? Roger, who was it? Myron and Roger Hernandez. Come on out. We're going to be over there looking at the power of creative evangelism. We're going to give some awards out tonight, and you will be somewhat in the spirit of The Voice and Shark Tank, be able to vote on those who have the most creative approaches to evangelism tonight immediately after this service in Mosley Chapel, which is directly behind you. We will see you in this building tomorrow at 8 a.m.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this message tonight. Lord, thank you for the ministry of music. And Lord, allow us to go back to our church on fire for you. Lord, be with us throughout the night. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.